Welcome to the Garage Series from New Orleans. My name is Jeremy Chapman.
And I'm Kyle Chupo.
So Paul, we've got a great episode today about touch and immersive experiences from the new office.
We'll see how Office works great on Windows 8 because Office did a lot to invest in the touch APIs of Windows, including leveraging the hit targeting.
Right, we've done a lot of work not only in Windows 8, also in the browser, also on phones and in large screen experiences or PPIs like we have back here behind us.
And that's exactly what we'll cover in today's episode. We'll see Office working on Windows 8, we'll see it working across devices thanks to the web app, and we'll also see it on very large devices.
Excellent, but before we get started, let's have a look at today's trivia.
True or false? You have to switch to touch mode to enable touch capability in the new Office.
Stay tuned for the answer at the end of the show. So Tal, devices have been evolving, changing. If you think about Office back in the old days, it was, you know, mouse and keyboard, maybe a desktop PC.
Well, it's no surprise at all because devices keep getting smaller. People want to take them everywhere. Assuming that you don't want to schlep the keyboard and the mouse anywhere, you got to use touch.
Right, and we're seeing people using devices of all types, all form factors. If you think about everything from phones, you know, Windows PCs themselves, Windows RT even, all of these things are supporting touch. In fact, it's gotten to the point where I'll start touching screens on devices that don't even support it.
Right, I see my kid doing it every day. But the thing is that when you take a device on the go and you're in a mobile scenario, it's not necessarily that you do everything that you do exactly like on the desktop. And that's why you need to really reimagine the applications for a touch environment.
Right, we've done a lot of that work. And we actually posted some of this stuff when we did the Garage Series Live a few weeks back, where we had Yoni Kirsch, my co-host of the Garage Series, do a really long touch demo about all the things that we're doing across the new office. Let's roll that clip.
What I have here is Word 2010 open. And you'll notice that I actually have Word 2013 open side by side as well, courtesy to Click to Run install. And what you can see here is that this software really is engineered to be used with the precision of a mouse. You know, I can move through the menus very easily. I can scroll with the wheel, and I can select the settings that I need to pick. However, when I start trying to operate this as a touch device very quickly, we discover that my fingers are a little bit too fat to navigate around. And you'll find that the same is true in 2013 as well. I have this same challenge where, you know, I struggle to get my finger in there.
If you're in mouse and keyboard mode.
Right, exactly. So right up until we hit this touch mode button right here, and you'll see what happened is the whole user interface is kind of expanded out. There's much bigger gaps between all the buttons, which means that I can very easily select what I'm trying to do. The drop downs have much wider arrows on them. And everything has a really nice high fidelity touch look and feel to it. And what you'll find is that if you're working on a touch device, maybe you're sitting in an airport lounge or whatever it is, then disregarding the touchpad and typing, but then using touch to navigate around the application becomes very natural. And of course, that extends over into the other applications such as Outlook, and we can see here that there's really a whole bunch of the user interface has kind of been shrunk down and to let us focus on the content that's actually in our emails here. So if this was, say, a tablet form factor device, we've got these nice thumb buttons that I can do replies, deletes, or, you know, even scroll through my different folders here at the same time. Of course, that experience isn't limited just to the full Outlook application. We have a really fantastic experience in the web app as well. You can see this is the full web app client, and that's been optimized for touch as well. Now, this is the one that you might use on a touch-enabled laptop device. What if you're on a tablet device, Jeremy?
Yeah, and you might not even have, for example, the full clients installed, right?
Right, you might not have the full Outlook clients. So say you're on a Surface IT and you wanted the Outlook experience, here's another view that we have of the Outlook web app that's totally optimized for touch. You can see nice big buttons. We can go back to our main view and pull up our calendar. Once again, the calendar is nicely zoomed in and out for week view or month view or whatever that is. So there you have it.
Right, and then we also have the ability, if we've got to say a smaller, taller screen, like a phone or something, to actually have the device or the Outlook web app experience tailored to that device as well. So why don't you go ahead and take us through that, Yoni?
Yeah, so what I have here would be the equivalent of, say, a phone device. And this of course, works on the Windows platform, also works on iOS. So if you wanted to get at your Outlook mail account from that web app, you can see that we've got a nice touch-enabled application there, and it has the same look and feel as the other ones. We can go through our contact list, calendar, and mail as well. But of course, what a touch demo would be complete
without OneNote.
Without OneNote, right? So what I have is I have the OneNote application running here, and if I select some text here, you'll see that these radial menus pop out, and these are really awesome. Just using the touch interface, I can change the size of the text there, and you know, or even the color. I can select that I'm looking for reds, and then pick that I want that to be the color. At the same time, I have the opportunity to use the other hardware and the device. So say, for example, here we go. I can take a picture of the guy sitting on the couch there.
Great picture.
And I'm happy with that. And then that's right there into Outlook. So there you have it.
That was a great demo, Jerry.
Certainly was. But we had just scratched the surface. We really talked about all the different things, but we didn't go into a lot of depth. And what I wanted to do, since I've got the man for PowerPoint here, is go into some of the lesser known features and really show what PowerPoint can do in a touch environment.
Happy to. So let me grab my tablet here and show you what it's all about. So here we are in PowerPoint, and as you can see, I can very easily go into slideshow using my finger to touch it. And in slideshow, you can see that I'm simply swiping to go in between the slides. Now in this slide, it's kind of busy, and I want to focus only on the relevant pieces, so let me make it all go away. And then I'm tapping on the various hotspots, and you see the callouts coming in, and I can as easily tap to make it go out. I can even use these as links to other slides in the deck. Now in this slide, colors really pop, but nightlife is kind of in stark contrast. So let me go here and change it by selecting it and use a new feature called the eyedropper. And when I use the eyedropper with my pen, you can see that I hover over the various areas, and it samples the colors, shows me a preview of the color I'm about to sample. Wow. And when I'm happy about it, I simply click and it's done. The reason I'm showing it that the eyedropper requires a hover behavior with a pen or a mouse. Mm-hmm. And when I tap on the font with my finger, you see that the eyedropper is actually not there in the menu. Because, well, I don't know if you try to hover with your finger in touch, but I wouldn't hold my breath for something to happen. No. So now that I'm happy about the slide, let's go back to the slideshow, and I'm using some shamelessly gratuitous animation.
Love those.
And you can see these transitions in between the slides, the origami one. And now on this slide, I have the Louisiana area, but I want to call attention just to the Louisiana section. So
right.
I did that by applying a grayscale effect on the background and colored only the Louisiana area and highlighted even the wetlands.
Very cool.
How did I do that? Let's go check it out. So I'm using here a combination of touch and a new feature called merge shapes. Mm-hmm. I'll start by tracing the Louisiana area with a freeform shape. So I'm selecting the freeform shape, and now I'm tracing it just like my 3.5-year-old would do. I'm simply going over the borders and simply selecting all the right points here, continue to trace. Very simple, very intuitive, thanks to the pen. It's just like you would do on paper in a coloring book.
Nice.
Now that I'm done, I simply close the shape. I'll select the background image, and I'll also tap together with it on the new map shape. I'll go to copy, but not select copy, but rather duplicate. And under format, merge shapes, I'll select intersect to merge the background image with this shape of a map.
Okay.
Now I'll place it exactly where it belongs. I'll delete the former shape that I don't need any longer. And now I can use some color effects on the picture to oversaturate it and call attention specifically to it.
Wow.
All that remains now is just bring the title to the foreground, and we're done. And we can very easily continue on to slideshow. So that's a great way to combine these touch capabilities and some of the new features.
So you selected like all that with the stylus, though, when you're running the menus?
No, and with my finger. Okay. I use them interchangeably. And now I simply pinched to go into the slide navigator, which gives me a thumbnails view. I can jump in between the sections, as you can see. On this slide, what do you think? Who got more recipes on the web, NutriRat or shrimp?
Pretty sure it's shrimp, but I'm kind of curious how many NutriRat and alligator recipes there are.
Well, you can see that I just tapped these and these come in, and indeed you were right, the shrimp got it. And I'm using your trigger animations to make the chart more interactive. Let's see how I apply this trigger animation right here on the
slide. You used also what we just saw for the icons of the rat and the alligator.
Exactly. So I have it already applied to two recipes. I'll apply it only on the third right now, Nurture Jambalaya. What I need to do is to start by adding animations under the Animations tab. So I'll add animation of fly in, but I want to have it fly in from the right. Now I'll add a second animation. It's an exit animation of fly out. And I'll make it fly out to the right, so it's in the same direction.
Right.
Now I want to tweak these animations slightly, so I'll go to the animation pane, and under the effect options, I will make the fly in option have a smooth end, because that will make it glide in a more seamless way. And I'll of course take the fly out animation and apply the same effect, but on a smooth start. Mm-hmm. And I'm using, of course, touch for all of these, you see from the circle when I interact with these.
Yes.
Now I will apply the trigger animation, click of the Nutria icon, and I'll choose the flyout animation as well and apply the trigger of the Nutria icon. And if you were wondering how I named these icons so neatly, well, if you go under the Home tab to the Selection pane, you can see here all the shapes and groups on the slide, and you can change the names here, which makes it a lot easier to work.
Very useful feature.
During the animation, yes. So now that it's on place, I'll go into Slideshow. And first I'll bring up the bars in my interactive chart. But once the bars are there, I can click any of the icons to bring the respective recipe and also make it go out.
And there's your Nutria Jambalaya.
Yeah. And in the case of the alligator popcorn, if I want to show you more, I can simply expand my fingers to focus on a particular area of the slide and focus your attention there.
Wow, that's great stuff. Right, so it's a great show of what we can do on a tablet, but what about this PPI that we've got back here that we're using on the garage pretty much every week? I've actually got Tim Bakke from the PPI team to show us a bunch of demos on the PPI.
So you guys on the garage show are awesome users of PPI.
Thank you.
Perceptive Pixel Incorporated is what PPI stands for. We actually Microsoft acquired the company in July of last year. Mm-hmm. And Jeff Hahn, who is a brilliant innovator in the field of touch, was the founder of the company. And now he's actually works in the office division. And that's where the Perceptive Pixel team is.
And it's really important that Perceptive Pixel's there because we want to make sure the office gets better and better and better for these whiteboard and productivity scenarios.
Exactly. So what we're trying to show is how these devices can be used in those types of scenarios. The everyday scenario of communicate, collaborate, and present. So I'm going to show a couple of different applications here. And one that I like to start with is one called Sensor View. And this just sort of gives you a very quick taste of all the information that the Perceptive Pixel can pick up. So as I'm touching it and I'm working with it, you can see that it's pressure sensitive. So my finger traces across there. And as I get wide, it also feels that touch and the line expands with it. We've got massive multi-touch, so multiple people can be participating into it.
Right.
Come on, feel it.
I can feel it.
But it also recognizes the difference between pen and touch. So in our world, this is for manipulation, this is for content. So I may be manipulating an application instead of writing with my finger, I write with the stylus. So I can manipulate the surface, but with the stylus, I can do the same thing. It's also pressure sensitive. So as I also get my hover, scenarios with the stylus. But as I push on it, you get the nice smooth line with the pressure sensitivity.
Very good for the calligraphers out there.
Exactly. But when we talk about productivity, it's standard office. So one of the big benefits of these PPI devices is just Windows. So people ask us, well, what's the technology behind it?
Yeah, what's driving it? There's actually a Windows PC behind it.
Exactly. So we've run them on everything from really beefy servers to laptops. Mm-hmm. The key thing is just making sure you got a good video card. And we've got specs, minimum specs posted on our website for all of that.
Right.
But this is an application that was actually developed for Windows 8. So developed for the Surface, and it allows you to manipulate a 3D animation of a CAD drawing. So this is using a file type called JT, which is sort of the JPEG of CAD drawings. So I don't have to have a big CAD application to manipulate this kind of a rendering. So let's say, for instance, you know, we're going to build a motorcycle, kind of the garage theme. You know, I got my Triumph shirt showing my colors for those motorcycles. But as a designer, I may be looking at this and interacting with this and using it as sort of my ideation space. But of course, we don't need a muffler if we're going to design the motorcycle to
be an electric motorcycle,
right? Yeah. So I'm going to take a snapshot of this, take a snapshot of that, and actually put it into one of my favorite applications for PPI is just OneNote.
Right.
So being able to paste that image into OneNote and then using my stylus, annotate on it. So obviously, we don't need a muffler. And I can use these notes from my design team to keep our project folder. Using the power of Office 365 and SkyDrive and just what's built into to OneNote itself,
right.
I can share these files out.
We can do real-time co-authoring, any of that
exactly
stuff.
Exactly right.
Very
exactly
cool.
Right. So this is great. We use it a lot for whiteboarding applications. I can do all my my note-taking, my ideation for my project team and keep all of them in this project notebook. But what's also really cool is, going back to the desktop, looking at some of the other applications within the Office community that are designed for PPI. So let's look at Excel. This is an application, let's say we're gonna look at demographic information for our motorcycle.
Now this is the GeoFlow add-in, right?
Exactly right. So GeoFlow is a plugin that goes into Excel, but what it allows me to do is do fly-throughs of tabular information. There's no back-end database, there's nothing really complicated for
right.
me to be able to use GeoFlow and to add really cool animations. And so this really kind of hits the presentation aspects of this type of device. It's more of a walk up and use kind of thing where I'm interacting with the data just like you guys in the garage do with
wow.
your annotating XML files and whatnot.
And some people say there's no touch application for using Excel, but this is definitely one thing where it shines on the PPI.
Definitely. So let's look at one of our go-to apps as well, PowerPoint.
Right.
So we got our garage stuff. You'll notice that the way that I've set up this application or this PowerPoint file is to use transitions. You show some really awesome transitions in your piece.
Yeah.
We use transitions that kind of show this element of I'm interacting with the slides in a slightly different way.
Mm-hmm.
So when I move through them, we're actually looking like we're manipulating the actual slides. So here, you know, some...
And you can go the other way if you're a lefty.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. If I was standing on the other side,
yeah,
I'd just
pull
it towards me. So I can pull in documentation, I can pull in images from other files. This is actually a Visio file. And what's interesting is because of what's built into to PowerPoint, I can actually start doing my annotations right in here. So let's look at this and say, okay, well, for us to retool this motorcycle, we need to change our manufacturing process, change the factory layout.
Right.
So all of my notes that I'm keeping in the application when I'm doing my presentation are kept inside the PowerPoint file, so I can share that afterwards. So think about it in the common scenario when people are showing information, they're taking notes on whiteboards, and
mm-hmm.
then they're taking pictures of it, and then emailing that around, right?
Right.
So because we're using OneNote, because we're using PowerPoint, all of that is captured within the file.
Awesome stuff. So the PPI really does a lot of cool things. It really has enabled us in the Garage series to do a lot more diagramming, architecture, is all the different things around how the technology works, and really is changing the way that we work out there as we're conducting meetings and all of these things.
Exactly right.
So, thanks, Tim. We actually had today's trivia question as well about touch mode.
True or false? You have to switch to touch mode to enable touch capability in the new Office.
So, Tal, do you know the answer?
Of course it's false, because you don't have to be in touch mode to use touch with Office. All you need to do is reach out and touch the screen, and the menu will open in the right mode for you.
Excellent. And we also support touch just in general across the apps and in the web apps and on large screen displays like Tim showed.
Right. I mean, the whole experience is we want to make sure that the users have access to the content that they need on whatever device they're using, whether it's a small form factor like the phone all the way up to devices like PPI.
Right. And we covered all that ground and more in this episode. So we talked about touch on our tablet devices on the PPI. We did some higher-end PowerPoint demos, what we can do now with the new PowerPoint.
Yeah.
So pretty cool stuff. All of this information and more can be found at microsoft.com/garage. Thanks for watching and goodbye for now.